Welcome to Introductory Biology. This is the first of your flipped lectures, and we're going to start at the very beginning. We will be looking at the history of evolutionary thought, and this will have various philosophical, theological, and geological aspects. The ancient origins of biology begin with the ancient Greeks. Both Plato and Aristotle were interested in what might explain biological diversity. Plato considered species to be constrained by an ideal form. There was some perfect way to be a sparrow. There was some perfect way to be an elephant. Aristotle, building on Plato's initial ideas, wrote The History of Animals, in which he tried to describe the natural history or the kind of basic biological details of over 500 different species of animal. Building on Plato's ideas, Aristotle developed what he called a scale of nature. He felt that lower organisms move up a great chain of being through a continuous striving for perfection. And so you'd have all the way at the bottom inanimate matter that somehow wanted to become a plant, okay? And so he thought that life constantly emerged from nothing, that no, dirt wants to be alive, and then simple living things want to be more complicated. And these were constantly replacing forms that rose higher and higher up the ladder. Okay, so we have the inanimate going through plants, sponges, spiders, snails, lobsters, octopus, fish, dolphins, reptiles, birds, mammals to humans, and then they go up to perfection. Okay? So the point of this, though, was that each form passed through the next ideal form above it of pre-existing species. So you had this ideal way to be a sparrow, and if you were lower on the chain than that, you would end up as a higher, better sparrow, and then you'd go on to be something above that. Okay? Well, we lost a lot of thought and literature with the Dark Ages in Europe, and the only thoughtful science going on for a very long time were in Arabia. And one of the most famous scientists of the Middle Ages, Ibn Sina, who is also known as Avicenna, who lived between 980 and 1037, was an extraordinarily gifted scientist. He wrote a book called The Book of Healing in the year 1014 and 27. He's known as the father of geology. And he developed some very interesting ideas about how formations of rocks are laid down on the earth. He originated this idea called uniformitarianism. And what he was really saying is, you know, things have been happening for a long time, and they would act in the same way then as they do now. There's nothing really new about geological processes. They've always been like this. He also developed the law of superposition. That means that you have a bedrock, and new rocks are laid down on top. And as you go higher up, you're getting to younger and younger strata of rocks. We finally have the Renaissance in Europe, and Leonardo was a great proponent of the scientific enterprise. And he traveled a lot. Besides being a great sculptor, writer, and thinker, he also was a naturalist. And he would climb up in the mountains and he would see fossils that didn't reflect anything like the circumstances of modern times. And so he wrote, "It must be presumed that there were sea coasts where all the shells were thrown up, broken, and divided. Since things are much more ancient than letters, it is no marvel if, in our day, no records exist of these seas having covered so many countries." So what he's saying is that before people could read and write, before there was anybody to kind of make a video of everything that was happening, things were happening. And the world was a very different place. And that what are now mountains may once have been seabeds, and that's how these fossil seashells now appear on the peaks of the mountains. Later, we come to Northern Europe, and we have a way of thinking about natural history called natural theology, and its most famous proponent of that point of view is a Swedish scientist named Carl Linnaeus, who lived from 1707 to 1778. And he wrote a very famous pamphlet first in 1735, which he then revised over the following decades. He called the Systema Naturae. And he wrote that the study of nature will reveal the divine order of God's creation, and it is the naturalist's task to construct a natural classification that will reveal this order in the universe. So he was really trying to understand something about theology by seeing patterns of different species in nature. Now, shortly after Linnaeus came William Smith, who kind of brought back some of the ideas of Ibn Sina into European science. So in 1794, he wrote a book called The Law of Faunal Succession. And he was very interested in the fact that you would find in certain layers of the rocks certain fossils, implying that they existed over a period of time. The rocks that were laid down during this time period would reflect the species that were alive. And then if you come up to a higher strata, yes, they're younger, as superposition told us from Ibn Sina, but they'd have associated species of organisms that were alive during that time. And so if you knew the rock here, it would have this characteristic suite of species, and it might be very different as you come up here. And this would tell you roughly something about the timing of the different ecosystems when they were being fossilized. So you had fossil assemblages that would succeed one another through time in a very predictable order, that the trilobites were always below the dinosaurs, for example. And if you went to a different part of the world and you found the same sequence, you would again say, yep, you're going to have your trilobites down here, and if you do have dinosaurs, they're going to be up above. And about the same time, about the same period in terms of strata being reflected. Then a very important geologist came along in the early 1800s, Charles Lyell. He wrote a very famous book called The Principles of Geology, and for his frontispiece, he had an etching of an ancient Greek temple in the Mediterranean near Naples that had been built on land, but at some point since Greek times, the land must have subsided. That allowed the barnacles and mollusks to attach here and leave scars, and then subsequently the land rose up again. And so now you have this high water mark that's well and truly on land. But what he surmised from that is that events are going to cause the rise and fall of land. These particular ruins, he understood, were raised quite quickly during an earthquake in September of 1438, but that followed a long period of subsidence. With uplift, subsidence. So he then said that the forces molding the planet, these subsidence and uplift today, have operated continuously throughout Earth's history. So very much like the uniformitarianism of Ibn Sina. So beginning at the 19th century, there is now a field of biology. We've got Linnaeus, who's been doing his classification since the 1700s, and European scientists realized that like the trilobites, like the dinosaurs, species would appear and then disappear. There must be some mechanism allowing species to change through time, so the concept of biological evolution was widely accepted in the scientific community. The big question is, what was the precise mechanism of evolutionary change?